What's up, everybody? Welcome to IGN Game Scoop. I'm your host, Daemon Hatfield. Joining me this week are Sam Claiborn.
We're back.
And Justin Davis.
Scoop.
We had a great show for you this week. We had a surprising amount of cool indie game news today. We've got Slay the Spire 2. We have an awesome new new content coming to Vampire Survivors. I don't know if you saw this one, Justin, but it's very cool.
Yep, I did.
But first, Star Wars Outlaws. We got a new story trailer for this and a release date, August 30th. So it's nice to finally know when we'll be playing that. I remain excited to play this game. I think it looks very cool. How are we feeling about this? Sam, are you...
First of all, no issues. I have. I think it's so good. I think Jabba looks awesome.
Jabba looks better than he does in the special edition.
In the special editions, that's exactly right. It's shocking. A lot of the faces of the aliens look cool. Like the people just kind of look, I don't know, like it looks a little bit next gen for the facial animations and stuff. And I just, you know, this is a story trailer, so you're going to see a lot of really pretty stuff. And Ubisoft is really good at making very pretty story trailers.
That's true.
You know, we've already seen gameplay, though. It's not like we haven't seen it. So just the combination of the two remains to be seen.
Yeah, I mean, I'm into it. There's no Jedi, at least in this trailer. No Jedi, no lightsabers, and no force powers. But I wonder...
Yeah, it's like, season one of The Mandalorian, right?
But yeah, well...
Yeah.
Can they really resist? By another way I put it, by the end of this game, are we going to be part of the rebellion?
No. Yeah, I was surprised to see the full on Han Solo carbonite.
Yeah.
But then that prepped me for being like, oh, okay, this is just straight up in the span of years that we all know really well. Mm-hmm. So there's going to be probably, you know, references to all this stuff, and that's, you know, it's not always ideal in Star Wars to have that. It's kind of nice to have new stuff, but I don't know. Jabba's palace looks cool.
Yeah,
everything looks cool here. It looks moody and neat and. You know, like at least it's a familiar zone to play a video game. I don't know if I want shows set here now, but or movies, but like I'm so down to play video games in this time period. So
Yeah.
I think it looks great.
Well, I wonder what
I think like it looks good, right? Like for a Ubisoft like kind of next gen game, this is like the best looking game I think they've shown off.
Well, and I think it's coming out at the right time. I mean, we don't know exactly what's going to be happening at the end of the year, but it's sort of like the summer movie season always kicks off. You know, it's like Dune. It's like that movie came out in March, and it's like the start of the season. It feels like this game is kind of kicking off, you know, the big fall video games. I'm glad it's coming out now instead of October 28th or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. That robot uses a force power there, right? Is that what's happening?
That's 100% how this is going to end, by the way, is her, like, discovery. Like, the stinger is going to be like, wait, what? Like, she's going to have some force power.
Oh, my God.
I shouldn't.
Well, because, like, what are your upgrade? You know, what's your upgrade tree without force powers, right? It's going to be like, what is it going to be? Like, more lasers, you know?
Well, she has some kind of
jetpack.
Kind of a hook, like a grapple hook things. So maybe you can upgrade that.
Because this is sort of OG trilogy coded, you know, and it's in that time frame that like they play up like, you know, a 70s haircut. Like, Star Wars has.
That's a good point.
A little bit of an identity crisis with that stuff where like when it came out, everything was futuristic. But now it's sort of become retro futuristic because Star Wars is like 50 years old. So you know, like that can be a struggle sometimes, a challenge for storytellers. But I think that it really works here.
Laser punk, right?
Yeah, it's cool. I think it's really nice.
Yeah.
Now there's some bullshit. You get to play this game 3 days early if you pay a lot of money.
Yes. Hold on. I want to get that.
Okay.
But first, I can't remember the name of our protagonist. I like her whole vibe though.
Oh.
But someone in the comments, I thought this was very funny. They said she looks familiar, and they put a picture of her side by side with April O'Neil in the Ninja Turtles cartoon. And they do kind of have a very similar hairstyle and vibe going on. I thought that
really?
Was funny. Yeah.
That's great. What about April O'Neil on the side of the TMNT arcade game?
That's different. Different. That's an off brand.
That's different.
Aw.
Yeah, you're right. You can play the game 3 days early, Sam, if you get either of the special editions, I believe. That's not the bullshit I thought you were going to say. I thought you were going to say that it requires an internet connection to install.
That too. I was going to get to the whole list. Okay, there's also they're expensive editions to pre-order.
It's like a $130 fancy edition of the game. So on the one hand, you know, Ubisoft is going to Ubi and like, sure, pay $100 and you can play it early or whatever. But on the other hand, you know, as we've talked about on Scoop a lot, it feels impossible to make like a profitable, successful video game anymore. So maybe it's like, well... you know, okay, like, you know, we'd like you to be able to, like, this is just what it costs to make a game of this price and this budget now.
Right.
Also, just, we've seen examples like last year with Starfield, like, people will do it. They'll pay extra to play early. So, you know, I mean, as a business, well, it's hard to say, well, no, we're not going to do that.
But in Starfield's case, it was on Game Pass, right? So, like, what I did was I bought that fancy edition that was whatever it cost, $20 or $30, and it also gets you the first DLC, and you get to play it early, and then I never had to buy the game.
Sure.
Yeah. So then the storage thing.
You have to have the one-time thing. Internet connection to install the game.
Okay.
Which could be because there's a required day one patch. So they want you to have that patch so it runs the best. I'm guessing here. It's either that or there's some sort of a security check to make sure your copy's legit, right?
Yeah. Well, we had a meeting about this earlier this week where we were kind of talking about this is one of the death knells of physical media. Like we're not getting physical media anymore. Like it's just going away. Like it's funny to get these in-betweens because those feel like the end more than people being like, hey, our next console doesn't have a disc slot. Like these ones where they're like, yeah, you can buy the piece of paper that's folded in a jewel case at a disc, but it don't do anything.
Yeah, if 20 years from now you buy a used copy of this game or find one in a flea market or whatever, like, could you put it in a PS5 and play it? Like, I don't know. Like, you know, you could for any Star Wars game, you could for, you know, Shadows of the Empire on your N64, right? But maybe not this. It's a bummer.
Yeah, I get it. I think in the short term, very few people, this will be won't be an issue for very many people. But in an example that you just gave, Justin, sure.
Yeah.
I don't know. It does
look like a very fun game to play, though. So, like, there's always something to kind of nitpick about game releases now and stuff like that. But, like, you know, this is the game I'm looking forward to most.
Yeah, me too.
It just is at this point.
Well, think about it. We're getting this and Indiana Jones this year, right?
Yeah. So funny. Well, we're getting two freaking Prince of Persia this year also.
Well, yeah, we'll talk about that. We'll talk about that in a little bit, too. Yeah, no, I think this looks great. I'm very excited for it. I'm trying to think. The last, like, Ubisoft open world game that I was super into, I think, was Assassin's Creed Odyssey. I played Valhalla for a while, but got bored. And, well, same thing with Far Cry 6. Played for a while.
I liked Valhalla. I was into Valhalla. Odyssey was great, but
I don't think, I am not convinced that Assassin's Creed Valhalla ends. I think that game just goes on forever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Star Wars Outlaws is out August 30th. So that puts it a week before Stalker 2. You're trying to plan your summer gaming sessions. And it's like, it's like 2 weeks after Black Myth Wukong. I think those are the only two big games in its vicinity, in its orbit at the moment. Man, this game looks fun, though.
It does look fun. You know, August games always make me happy, too. I believe Bioshock was an August game, or at least an early September game. Yeah, it's just like was one of those games ahead of the rush of the season. And then I think some of the Metroid Primes have come out that way too, maybe Metroid 2 or something like that. I remember being like really, or Pikmin, right? Like the middle of the end of July or whatever, and playing these like big Nintendo games. I love that feeling. And so I just think it's super cool to have this as a summer game.
Yeah. Okay, moving on. Xbox is full speed ahead working on the next generation Xbox.
Mm-hmm.
Xbox President Sarah Bond said they're focused on delivering the biggest technological leap ever in a generation. So a couple of things here. I think it's a little bit, you know, we're 4 years into this gen. It's not surprising that they would be working on it at this point. I think it's surprising that they would admit it publicly when presumably they still want to sell the Xbox Series X.
That's always been the thing. That's why Nintendo never says anything, right? And then they're the opposite end of it. They're like, no, we're never making a console again. And then like 3 months later, they're like, hey, here's the console we've been working on. We forgot to tell you.
Yeah, I think that there's a couple things. I think there's been all the chatter about Xbox and, you know, is there going to be Xboxes anymore? That this is them, you know, putting a stake in the ground with regard to that.
They have a different problem with that, right? They have to answer that question and then also push Game Pass, which is their business. So it's like, it's kind of interesting. They've kind of moved beyond the worry of people not buying hardware this year because they're going to be like, well, we have a million games for you to play going forward. What are you going to play it on? Like, it's a challenge, you know?
I mean, I've said many times that I like my Xbox Series X more than my PS5. Play it much more. Got to be five times more at this point. But you can get Xbox Series X's for $300 or $350 sometimes. It's supposed to be a $500 console. Like, they're struggling a little bit, right? Like, they've fallen behind. So they're, you know, they're doing their best. They're doing what they can do to play catch up.
So I got like a nice, you know, like a, what do you call them? Like a bureau or a, you know, a cabinet, a mid-century cabinet. And, you know, it's really pretty and everything. And I ruined it finally by putting holes in the back so I could put my consoles inside, because they've been on top of it, like under the TV for a long time. And I was like, this furniture piece is really pretty, and I wanted to kind of hide them. So I drill it out, and then I'm like, oh my God. I measured this already, but I was like, the PS5, right? That's a problem, right? It's never going to go vertical in anything. So I'm going to put it on its side. But I was like, I really wanted the Xbox next to it. And I had measured. But it turned out like those fins and then the way like the cables are in there and everything, they are like mashed in what looks like, you know, like an underwear drawer. Yeah. And like the only reason I'm paying attention to this now is that right in the middle of an open world area in Final Fantasy, I just hear that like jet engine turn on. And I know like through the rest of my life, I'm going to be basically opening this like, you know, credenza drawer to air out the damn PlayStation. We'll see how it goes. But I have so much respect for that Series X profile. And like, if for the rest of my life, they just make nice little bricks that you can stash away or stack, I'll be so happy. I'm like, I'm completely over the PlayStation design. It's so silly.
I really dislike it. What was the
clip? It rocks back and forth when you set it down, you know, until you put it on that little thing that doesn't actually fit. It's so funny.
The quote was, it's the most powerful, whatever.
The biggest technological leap ever in a generation.
So this reminds me of any time you go to any city, it doesn't matter. It could be a town of 10,000 people or a million people. There's going to be a restaurant that's like, we have our world famous waffles.
Yeah.
Come have our world famous. The best pork tenderloin in the country is here. Oh, really? It is. It's here in Solon, Iowa. Like, I didn't know. And like, that's what, like every single video game console that's ever come out has universally been described as, you know, the most powerful, biggest leap in computing. It's like, give me a break. They're doing that, by the way, they're trying to do that with like 8K TVs now, where like they're trying to get you to buy an 8K TV, and the 4K footage that they show side by side is like this smeared, blurry, like low pixel mess. And it's like, they've been doing that since like 480p. Like when we went to 1080p, they made your 720p TV look like junk. And like, then they did it with 4K. And I'm like, I don't think that trick is working on anybody anymore.
I mean, it's not... I agree with you, Justin. It's not even possible. Like think about this generation.
Yeah.
You know, like amazing games have come out this generation, but like the leap from PS4 to PS5 isn't that revolutionary or groundbreaking, right? Like, I feel like there are a lot of promises made that haven't even been fulfilled. The box of the PS5 has 8K on it, which doesn't even really mean anything.
Like, that's right. We were talking about this week. If everybody out there is wondering what I did with my Switch cradle, I basically tossed it in after getting all that stuff in there and I closed the door as fast as possible.
Okay, good. Good.
Now I'm wondering what actually is the biggest leap in console generations of all time. It's gotta be like
16 to
Super Nintendo, to PS1 and N64, right?
I think so.
Like Mario 64, Super Mario World to Mario 64 was unbelievable.
Yeah.
The Atari to the NES was a huge leap. I mean, you got every genre that exists today, except for like first-person shooters and Souls-like. Like on the NES, the Atari could do none of them except for tennis.
And I do think that like Mario 1 and Mario 3 to like Sonic the Hedgehog was a pretty big one too. Although part of that's just game design, just because Sonic was
fast. If you just look at Mario 3 and Adventure... Like, those are console generations? Like, that's just remarkable, you know?
Yeah.
Mario 3, what's Adventure?
Just the game where you are like a dot in Atari.
Oh, the game Adventure. Yes.
Yeah. I mean, those are, to bookend two generations, like, that's just, it's unfathomable to me.
Yeah.
Yeah. I also think
it's PS2 was a big leap too, right?
I mean, you know, Sega waited. They did a half gen, but like, the Dreamcast was like pretty good.
That's right. Yeah,
That was a pretty good leap too. And it's been it's been all downhill since then. It's been all downhill since the Dreamcast. That's what I always say.
Well, there's like, I think the general sentiment is that this generation has been a little bit underwhelming. Of course, developers even today are sort of still have sort of one foot in last generation. And just today, we've got an interview with Rod Ferguson of Blizzard where he basically says exactly what we've all been thinking this whole time. So he's the head of Diablo 4. Diablo 4 was released on PS4 and Xbox One. And he says, there's always a time and a place for when maybe it's time to no longer support a platform. I don't think we're at that time, but we have a long road for Diablo 4. So we talk about, hey, we have this idea for a feature, but maybe it's not a feature our min-spec or Gen 8 players can support, so it's not something we can do today.
Oh, no.
That's it.
That's so sad.
That's it right there. Right? He just said it.
He said the thing out loud.
Yep.
Can you play Diablo on an Xbox One?
Diablo
4, min spec?
And that's Gen 8.
So if you hook up your Kinect, you could start Diablo 4 with it.
With Kinect, presumably, yes.
Cool.
I see a video.
I intend to.
Someone slacked Destin. We got a project. it's a bummer. I agree about this gen. I mean, look, like some of my favorite video games of all time ever have come out this gen. So like the quality of like the top tier games has never been better. But like overall, from like a 10,000 foot console generation perspective, like it feels like it's winding down, and it feels like it never really got started.
Yeah, that's an overall sentiment. Plus, you know, Xbox is actively talking about their next generation console. We're 4 years deep into this generation, and then their own developers, because they own Blizzard now, their own developers are still trying to support drag along the Xbox One.
But that's like the classic move of like when you're in last place, or you're struggling, then you want to accelerate that console transition, right? Like Nintendo did it with the Wii U. Like, you know, it's in their best interest to be like, no, forget about the Xbox Series. Look, we got a new thing coming.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Man.
You should. Yeah, anyone that doesn't own an Xbox Series X, I think that you should buy one. I like it so much.
If you get a Series S, you can stack them next to each other and it's almost the same.
Ooh.
But similar profile.
Sam, the NES was very stackable. It's a nice little rectangle.
Hell yeah, it was. I remember back in the peak period of collecting NES, which was like, you know, 1998 to 2002, you could, you know, thrift store NESs for $5, right? And I just, amassed a closet shelf of so many of them. And, you know, my friends and roommates were not impressed. I really wish I still had it because it was the coolest looking thing ever. It was, you know, 30 probably. I was over 20 cool. NESs. It was the coolest big wall of them, you know.
My NES, it's the same one that I have now as an adult that I had when I was a kid. And I ruined it because I had made more progress in Metroid than I never made. Like I'd beaten Ridley or like figured out some secret that I'd never figured out. And then my mom was screaming at me because I had to go to a band concert. And in a panic, I couldn't find a piece of paper. So I wrote my passcode on top of the NES.
Oh my gosh.
And so it's just on there now, like this, whatever, this 20 digit code of things written in like a 6-year-old's horrible handwriting.
Magic eraser.
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure I could clean it up, but like,
I used to refurb them. And so I would just use a permanent marker or something. I have a bunch with like notes on the ones I still have of like the notes on just written right on the plastic too. I was like, why was I doing that? But it was because you can wash it off, but I just never did.
Okay. Let's move on to some of these, this III showcase that was today, the III Indie Gaming Showcase, where we got Slay the Spire 2. I think we knew this was happening, but this is sort of like officially announced now. It's coming out into early access in 2025. Obviously, very, very beloved game. Maybe the most, I don't know, Justin, is this like the most beloved, like sort of deck building roguelike game?
Yes. Well, I don't know if it's literally the original one, but it's the progenitor of the family tree of like roguelike deck building games. Like Slay the Spire spawned many, many imitators, and I don't know that it's ever been surpassed.
I love Slay the Spire. I have a couple hopes. I have just a couple critiques of the original game. First of all, I love the game, so I don't want to be too down, but I'm personally not crazy about the art style. I like what we're seeing of the art style here in this trailer a little bit more.
I mean, I was going to say, like, the one thing that the sequel for the that this game seems to have going for it is that it's, you know, it's a generation forward in graphics and visuals. Like, that's what, like, because I actually have the opposite complaint, Daemon, where I think that Slay the Spire 2, based off what we've seen so far, looks too similar. Same character classes. They show the merchant again. They show that big space whale guy again. Like, they show all that stuff. If like, it doesn't feel that different, except that everything is so much more high fidelity this time around. Like, they really seem to amp up the production value.
Well, that's a theory that I have. I think it's hard to make a sequel to a perfect roguelike game. I felt this was Spelunky 2, which is obviously very good. But you like you love the original. It's one of your favorite games of all time. You look forward to playing the sequel, and then you sit down with it, and it feels so familiar. You're like, wait a minute, like I've played this
before. Because you like the innovation on the roguelike, right? So like the iteration on the roguelike isn't as interesting.
Yeah.
Same with Rogue Legacy 2, and I've had that same feeling before.
Although it took me a while, but eventually I really ended up loving Rogue Legacy 2.
Yeah, I mean, usually they can one-up themselves, right? Like, they can do better, but it's like, are you just tired of it by then?
Yeah.
So this is like if you were forced to play Gwent and Witcher and Hell for the rest of your life, that's what this game is?
I don't know if I would say describe it that way. Maybe for you. I know it's famously Sam does not care for card games.
Thomas is
spectacular.
Yeah, it's a deck builder, so you start with the same set of 10 very basic cards, and then you add new cards to your deck each time, but they give you a menu of, like, they give you three choices of, like, what card do you want to add. So then it's sort of like, do you want to do a poison build or a build of, like, you know, defense or one big attack? And so you build your deck as you go, and so it's different each time.
Mm-hmm. What did the Spire ever do to you?
Yeah, I actually don't know. I mean, I beat all of Slay the Spire, including the secret sort of final floor. Like, I did all that stuff, but I never paid attention. Is there lore? I don't even actually know.
There probably is, but yeah, I don't pay attention to that either. You just want to watch the numbers. You just want to watch the poison build up, Justin. That's all I want to do is make the poison build up.
Yeah. Anyway. I always go for the poison build, and it's always a trap.
Well,
never works.
Still fun. Anyway, I'm just not crazy about this art style. I could use a little bit more in the presentation. Like, when enemies are defeated, they just kind of vibrate and disappear. Like, I'd love to see a great bespoke death animation, especially for big bosses. You know.
So, Daemon, I don't know if you caught this. They have, it wasn't in the trailer, but they released, it was very old school. They released screenshots that show actual gameplay.
Okay.
They released a photo album of screenshots. So you look them up after the show. It's the same, like 2D side view, but just everything looks bigger and nicer.
I saw the images. That's how I found out it was a card game.
Well, Daemon, are you going to go back to Darkest Dungeon 2 with its DLC announcement?
Well, I've never played Darkest Dungeon 2, Justin, because it's only on PC.
Oh, I didn't realize you never did it.
Yeah, still waiting for console release for that one. But I'll absolutely check it out.
Is it going to happen?
It'll happen at some point.
Yeah.
Happy with the first one. And then speaking of deck builders, Justin, were you aware that... I'm so annoyed by this. Hearthstone is removing its deck building mode next week.
What?
Which has been the most fun way to play Hearthstone for years now. It's duels.
What are you...
deck building mode. They're just pulling it out.
What? Yeah. Isn't that like the main... So wait, so what's left? Just the arena? Or like just the... I don't even remember
what it's
called.
Well, there's basic Hearthstone. Which is... Okay. You know, that's not a deck. No, you build your own decks, but it's not a deck building mode where you start with a set of cards and then you.
They're taking it out.
Yep, they're just taking it out. I'm assuming that they couldn't monetize it the way they hoped, so they're just going to pull it.
Oh boy,
I think it sucks. Like Justin would say, I don't like it.
I don't like it.
It's been the most fun way to play Hearthstone for years, and they're just yanking it out. Lame. Okay. Rogue Prince of Persia. What's funny about this is that this game was actually announced on April 1st, and until today, I assumed it was an April Fool's joke. A roguelike Prince of Persia from the developers of all the Dead Cells DLC, basically. So the developers of the Return to Castlevania content for Dead Cells. It's going to be...
Oh, I didn't realize that wasn't the main Dead Cells team.
Yeah, because they've announced the next game that they're making as well.
Okay.
They're often doing something else. So this is going to be a Prince of Persia that... feels very much like Dead Cells with wall running and parkour. Mm-hmm. Although, once again...
Interesting wall running.
Interesting wall running, yes. Although once again, here I am not loving this art style.
No, oh, I think it's great. I love it.
It's a little bit Little Prince for me. Like I don't really get
who
it.
Who doesn't love the Little Prince? Nice.
Nobody likes the Little Prince.
What?
That's why he lives on his planet by himself.
You don't know this, Sam, but 10% of GameScoop listeners have Little Prince tattoos. And you just made them all so mad.
No, I like Little Prince. But yeah, I don't know. Like the only thing is the contrast between this and Dead Cells, right? It's like have a game that's based on amazing rotoscoped, you know, 16-bit graphics, 8-bit graphics, and you went this way. It seems a little bit weird.
Here's a theory, Damon. Maybe they announced this on April 1st, and then everybody loved it so much that then they scrambled and decided to make it a real game. We got to get a team on it.
Yeah. The art style for this
one. I love
one
the
is...
little wall running. Like, did you see where you like where you slide down a wall in the background when you fall down? It's so cool. Yeah. And then Tristan's preview, which I recommend everybody check out. Shows a big part of this game is a Spartan kick, where like a lot of the time you don't need to fight an enemy, you can just knock them off a ledge into something. And I love that stuff. Yeah. It feels like such a good hack in a game.
Yeah, Motion Twin is the original developer of Dead Cells, and then Evil Empire is this like support studio that made Return to Castlevania. They're the ones that are making this rogue Prince of Persia. So maybe this is not true. My guess is that Motion Twin are the ones that created the incredible pixel art for Dead Cells, and the Evil Empire doesn't have those artists to do that. So this has like a very like simple sort of like Saturday morning cartoon style animation. It's not ugly. It's just, I'm particular. I think Dead Cells is an amazing looking game. One of the best looking games I've ever played, but it looks like it plays very much.
I can see I do want to encourage people to try different things. So I do think it's neat that they're doing something different. It just doesn't look appealing to me. But I think that the animations, as I mentioned, like they're really smooth and interesting looking. Like it's neat to see the little cartooniness of it play out. Aren't the enemies the same as Dead Cells? Is that right?
Well, they're like they're.
Yeah, Tristan was saying that like the first waves that he was playing, they're like based on the Dead Cells enemies.
They're just very similar.
Grenadiers and stuff like that.
And it's like Dead Cells, you pick a melee weapon and then a ranged weapon to start your run. Mm-hmm. You'll unlock the little portals around the map so you can easily fast travel to different areas of the map. It seems like it's going to be exactly Dead Cells, but Prince of Persia with more of a Saturday morning cartoon vibe.
Yeah, really interesting that they licensed Prince of Persia. I mean, especially this year.
I'm here for it.
We need a name for this phenomenon that's happening. Like studios like licensing out their library IP to smaller developers. I mean, like, we've got that new Contra game from WayForward earlier this year, of course, returned to Castlevania and Dead Cells last year. It's just happening more and more often. And this isn't even... There's another Castlevania...
How about we call them triple L games, triple licensed games?
Triple licensed games. Okay, cool. We can go with
that. Well, it's out in May in some beta form or full form?
Early access on May 14th.
Early access, okay. Mm-hmm.
One thing I noticed here, there's no map. And I wonder if that's strange. Dead Cells at least has a map you can pull up. Is there not a mini map on screen? I think there is in Dead Cells.
Oh, yeah, I like maps. Is there a... I'll save that for later. Okay. So NVIDIA 20 questions. If we asked if this was based on a license, what would you say?
Yes.
The purposes of that question, you're usually trying to find out if it's based on a movie or a TV show or a book.
Yeah, right? Exactly. That's
is it helpful? Is it helpful to you if I say yes? Probably not.
I said yes and then immediately wanted to walk that back. It's a video game based off a video game. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe we need to start asking, is this based on a TV, comic, or book series?
Yeah. Sam, you've said that the Prince of Persia Lost Crown might be your favorite game of the year so far, but I have to imagine a roguelike Prince of Persia is probably a deal breaker for you.
Oh, no. Remember, I don't like cards. I like roguelikes. I love Spelunky. I love Rogue Legacy.
Okay.
Those games are really fun. Dead Cells never got its claws in me. I don't know why Dead Cells didn't work, but this is totally something that I'd be willing to try. I think sometimes roguelikes are like a little bit of I get to the point where I'm like, why am I playing this game so much and I'm not having fun anymore? And that's, I think, what they're supposed to do. But that always happens before I like beat the final boss. So like I never beat them. You know, like I've gotten to Olmec, right? A couple times. I've never beat Olmec. There's like no way.
That's what I get stressed out by roguelikes, being able to take them at your own pace. The thing that's supposed to be like chill about them is actually stressful for me, where like some people are like, I beat Hades in like 18 runs and I'm at like run 30 and not anywhere close to winning. And then it just makes me not want to play anymore.
Yeah, I definitely didn't beat Hades. I don't think I've ever beat a roguelike. I mean, it's not where they lead me. Have you beat Spelunky, Damon? You haven't, right?
Well, I've also gotten to Olmec. I've told this story. I've made it to Olmec and then actually defeated him and then got killed by a bat before I could exit.
Oh, in the room, yeah. Well, and I just remember looking up videos of how to do Olmec, and there's like a really clever one where you like run from side to side and you do some kind of like bombing technique or something. I can't remember what it is, but you definitely go from side to side. And I was like, that makes so much sense. And then you like go to your game and you're just like, it's just over in like 2 seconds.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I didn't even get a chance to even perform this complex operation I tried to psych myself up into.
I don't have that like killer instinct of like, I gotta be like, if I make it to the final boss and die twice, I'm like, I'm good. Like I saw 99% of the game and that last 1%, I'm fine to not experience it.
Well, they're the ultimate like anti-save game, right? So it's like, you know, it's always shitty in Metroid when you're like, well, in Metroid 1, you have to like get all of the life to fill your tanks every time you start the game. You have to like sit in front of like a thing of gamers and just blast them for like 10 minutes to like get your life up and then go try a crate again. That's horseshit, too. Right? Like that's what it gets to with roguelikes, where it's like, well, I really want to try that boss and I really want to get back to him. But like, it's not any easier to, because in Spelunky, you have to have the right setup, which is a roll of the dice, which means that you don't have a guarantee of retrying that boss with any of your skills being, you know, in your muscle memory. I don't like that. I just think that's like kind of lame.
You can't unlock the stage gifts, but then that also doesn't help. It's not necessarily a help to just start at the hardest level, right?
No, because you don't have the stuff, right?
Yeah, you don't have anything. Okay, there's another couple Konami properties that have been shared around. V-Rising is getting Legacy of Castlevania, and V-Rising it's been in early access for a while. This is the game where you're a vampire and you wake up and have to start doing vampire things and build up your castle and stalk around at night and drink blood and all that sort of thing. And they're adding Simon Belmont to the game, where he's going to be hunting you. You don't play as Simon Belmont. You're the vampire, cool. So he's hunting you.
Nice.
I think it's like the vampire survival game, right? Not vampire survivors, right? But like, you know, that kind of like open world crafting survival game, but as a vampire.
It's the vampire tree punching game.
Yeah. Tree puncher.
Yeah.
And Simon Belmont Simon Belmondo, as he was once known, like appears as like a nemesis character.
Yeah. It'll be like, I don't know if it's a downloadable content to be added later. Or if it's just a special mode, but yeah, there's a tie-in with Castlevania where they're adding in Simon Belmont.
Cool. A miserable Hyrule's pile of secrets.
Yeah. And then speaking of Vampire Survivors, Sam, did you see the Vampire Survivors is getting Contra?
That makes no sense.
It looks really cool.
It doesn't make sense.
Like shooter style, right? Bullets, right?
So first of all, Vampire Survivors is finally coming to PlayStation. Later this July.
Did you watch the trailer?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
The trailer opens with Greg Miller.
It opens with Greg Miller shouting about it. Yeah. And yeah, so the Contra DLC is coming on May 9th. And it looks awesome. You got Bill and Lance in there. And all the familiar Contra weapons. But there's also like, this is I think this is the new one.
The DLC looks weird. I don't even know if this is going to be a hot take, because like I don't like the direction Vampire Survivors is going. I didn't like the last DLC very much either, where the arenas are becoming more kind of level-like.
Wait, go back to that,
Gilbert.
It's about to do the Contra stuff. Sorry, Justin, go ahead.
There's like, you know, there's in the new DLC, there's like a mountain for you to climb and like a forest for you to explore and like bridges to cross. And like, I actually don't know whether the community likes that stuff or not. But for me, I like it more when it's like an open arena and this crush of enemies, and that's what I'm here for. I'm not here for sort of the gimmicky spaces that the last couple DLCs have been. And I think the characters look great in this DLC. The new weapons look great, but I'm not, you know, the overall direction of Vampire Survivors, I could take or leave.
Ah, they should add Bub and Bob.
I don't think they would survive.
It's actually,
and Bimmy and Jimmy.
Yeah, so here they are. Bill and Lance with their familiar Contra weapons added to Vampire Survivors, and this just looks
cool.
Fantastic to me. Oh, there's also like weird, like what's happening here? Is that what you're talking about, Justin? Like,
yeah.
This looks more like a level, like a side-scrolling level.
Yeah.
Yeah, interesting.
I don't like it.
Yeah. You're a garlic-like purist.
Yeah, I don't know. Like they did at this III indie thing, they did show off the second, they showed act two of Death Must Die, which I think in the Damies I named the best garlic-like of last year. And, you know, and it was really, really good, but it was only the first act of the game. So I'm excited to see more of that's coming.
Operation Sam, Guns is a really good title.
Sam, this is the wolf guy from Contra Hardcore.
Yeah.
He's in the game too.
Brad Fang.
Operation Guns.
And then finally, Justin, they're making another Kingdom Rush. We're up to Kingdom Rush 5.
Yeah.
It's a little hard.
I mean, it's actually been a while.
It's hard to keep it all track because there's been so many Kingdom Rushes. And there's also been like plus versions that they've added to Apple Arcade. And then they've made spin-off games. Like I think Junk World was one of them. And there's an RPG one too. So there's a lot that's happened in the world of Kingdom Rush.
Yeah. I don't know that I played Kingdom Rush 4. Maybe that's the one where you play as the bad guy?
Yeah, maybe.
I can't remember.
3 was. I don't really remember. And this one, they're joining forces though. That's the whole concept here. So now you're going to have both the good guy and the bad guy towers to build.
Oh, okay. Are you facing off against an even badder guy?
Yep.
So that's a
bigger baddie.
Cool. I mean, I watched this trailer. Look, I have a real soft spot for Kingdom Rush. They're very charming and good tower defense games. The trailer, similar to the feedback I had earlier in the show, looks just like the other Kingdom Rush games.
They're all pretty much the same, right?
Yeah. But I give that sort of repetition a pass if you wait long enough. Like, it's been a long time. Like, it's been many years since the last Kingdom Rush. So it's like, okay, I'm ready to do this again. Like, if this game came out a year after Kingdom Rush 4, I might be more bummed.
I was thinking, it has been a long time since I've played a tower defense game.
Yeah.
And then when I was thinking about that, I was like, man, remember Plants vs. Zombies? That's so sad.
Yeah.
That what, like...
I mean...
Because
EA completely screwed it up.
They completely screwed it up. EA bought PopCap and they just screwed it up. Plants vs. Zombies is so good. And then Plants vs. Zombies 2 was just a free-to-play mobile game with like cooldown, you know, pay right now or wait a few hours to play the next level. So dumb. So bad.
Angry Birds strategy.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, ruined Angry Birds 2.
Okay, real quick, let's check in with the listeners real fast.
Oh,
hey, listeners.
Listeners, remember you can always reach us at the email address, gamescoop@ign.com, just like Rowan from Wollongong, Australia. Wollongong. Rowan says, hey, Gamescoop crew, since you guys were talking about pinball, I wanted to ask what you think is the best video game turned into a pinball machine. Is it Super Mario Bros.?
Like licensed.
There's not a lot of them, yeah. Let's see what we got. We have back in the day, they did Defender, they did Q-Bert,
and
they did Joust, which is head to head, which might be the best one ever. That one's really cool. You know, in recent times, you have two Super Mario Brothers games.
Two?
Not a lot. Yeah, there's the Mushroom World, which is a short boy, and it's still a full featured Gottlieb pinball machine, but it's a smaller profile and a yellow cabinet, and the Mario's in a profile and a blue cabinet. Behind me here.
Go ahead.
Well, there are more recent ones. Why am I blanking? What am I missing?
I really have a soft spot for that Mario table. That's what we had in our family business growing up. And so I spent a lot of time playing that pinball table and also bodying people at Street Fighter 2 because I would just sit there.
There's one for that. There's a pinball machine for Street Fighter 2. It's not good.
Really? Street Fighter 2 pinball?
Yeah, really. Yeah. You know what there's not one for? Is Sonic the Hedgehog. But there is a Baywatch one that has Sonic in the pixels advertising the game because it's made by Sega. So that's really cool. I think he's in some of the other Sega ones.
I want to watch, after Game Scoop ends, I'm going to watch some YouTube compilation of Dot Matrix displays, just like the best Dot Matrix animations from pinball history. There's so many weird and over and ridiculous
ones. Oh, yeah. Look, it has the car that you can beat up in it. That is one funny feature, but the game's not good. Here's a recent one. Roller Coaster Tycoon.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Really?
Isn't that funny? Yeah, yeah. That one was for, I mean, it's not recent now. It's 20 years old. But it's neat because it's like, it's very ugly, but it's based on that like turn of the century kind of like Roller Coaster Tycoon art, you know? And then it has really cool wire forms and ramps, right? Because it's all roller coaster based. Hmm. It's, I have a soft spot in my heart for that one. There it is.
Cool.
RCT, Roller Coaster Tycoon.
Wait, why is there a troll in it? Like a troll doll? Why is, why is he in
there? Nobody will ever know.
What do you mean?
It must have something to do with Roller Coaster Tycoon.
Yeah, I don't understand the question.
Great entertainment, family, friends.
Yeah. So yeah, and there's I'm sure. I mean, I, as I just said, I'm going to miss others, but I'm going to go with Jess because here's the thing with Jess. It is a head-to-head pinball machine. You go on either side of it, and you each have like half of a play field, and you can send the balls to the other person's play field and screw them over that way. It's kind of like sending junk in Tetris over, cool. But then they get to play for a little bit, and you know, it's just kind of chaotic and weird and. You're never going to learn it before it breaks at an event. It works for like the first 3 hours of California Extreme, and then it never worked after that. But it has great sounds. It's got like cool joust sounds in it. It's got cool, amazing art. And then like those cool, like, you know, gas displays. It's great.
Head-to-head pinball is such a good idea.
It's so cool. There's a soccer one from Gottlieb that we had a free goal watch for a while. That was really fun too. It's great. And it's sit down. You can sit at it.
Oh, I don't like that.
You don't have to. It's as tall as a regular machine.
Something just doesn't seem right about that. It's like sitting down to do the dishes in your kitchen. I'm like, I don't know. I know there's nothing wrong with it, but it doesn't seem right.
Or sitting down to play electric guitar in front of your rock and roll band. Hmm.
Yeah. 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 Some stuff you just got to be standing up for.
It's true.
But people do it.
There was apparently a Space Invaders one.
Yeah, that one's really funny because that one has like really badass art, like the side of the Space Invaders cabinet. And then like, it basically doesn't fit, you know, factor in Space Invaders at all. There's two Pac-Man ones. It's a wide body, by the way, the Space Invaders. It's kind of a slow, boring wide body. There's two Pac-Mans. There's of course Baby Pac-Man, which is a hybrid of Pac-Man and an arcade machine with a monitor in it. I like it. But there's a really cool one called Mr. and Mrs. Pac-Man. And that one, I've been helping a friend restore. It's really interesting because it has like a sunken thing of lamps that you play the Pac-Man maze out of. Like it's like lights and like it's very lo-fi, but it also has really funny call-outs. It's all these are both are based on the cartoon era of Pac-Man, mm-hmm. The Saturday morning cartoon, which have great art. Pac-Man. That's the sound it makes all the time.
There's also a Spy Hunter one.
Spy Hunter, yeah, that one's another one from that. The mid-80s, the Defender Joust run. So Spy Hunter is a little bit boring, but it has, you know, it looks cool. It's like a, you know, it's like a competent 80s simple game.
And this jogged my memory. I wanted to tell you, the local burger joint down the street from me just got Venom, the Venom machine.
Ooh. Yeah, that's I just cool. Completed my Venom unboxing and features video for IGN.
That's maybe up soon. Stern one, right?
Mm-hmm. It's pretty interesting. It has you know, really nice comic book art throughout. It's really near me right now. I've been playing it all morning for this video, or recording it for all the morning. But it has a neat aspect of it where when you hit a ball up a ramp and then it comes back to you on like a rail. Mm-hmm. Well, in this game, it actually stores a ball midway down that rail, and so by the time you've hit that ramp, the balls are already coming back to you. It skips half of the game to get back to you. It's terrifying. That's what it's showing you there. So it's like you're never quite ready for it until you kind of like play it a couple times. So I think it's really clever. And then it has a lot of like transforming metal cool things, like which is a lot of permutations, and they change who you play as. Do you Brock or Spider-Man, Black Suit, or Gwenom, or like there's other characters, and it changes the way that the play field, all these mechs move, and things go different directions because of it. Really, really clever. Always be changing. That's what the symbiotes say. You know?
Yeah, that's just the catch line.
Well, Rowan says, I bought a 1992 Super Mario Brothers pinball machine. Absolutely love it. The sounds the characters make sound like they just hired some random dude to do the voice acting, but it turns out it is, in fact, Charles Martinet. They just were still testing how they wanted Mario's voice to sound.
Yeah, he says some crazy stuff in it. He's like, oh, that's a scary ghost. One of the things he says. He says, gotta get to Yoshi. It's like completely crazy. It's unhinged. There's some other funny stuff where we're like, oh, and then the princess is in it. It totally sounds like somebody hired their friend to do it. You know, she's like, shoot the ball. She said over and over again, well, if so you don't start your game. Yeah. That was the first pinball machine I ever bought. Fantastic game. People that play pinball don't like it because Gottlieb games don't feel like pinball. But in terms of like a theme integration and like the fact that Nintendo worked with them on it, it's cool as hell. It's so cool. And like it has the Mario World and Mario 3 era stuff in it. It's got secrets in it because that was a big deal in Mario games back then. And they're really interesting. I just think it's a very cool example of a Gottlieb game, most of which are bad.
Yeah, I really like this table too.
Rowan says he owns a few machines. The 1976 Gottlieb Pioneer, the 1987 mm-hmm. Dungeons & Dragons from Bally.
Space.
Aforementioned Super
That's
Mario
Bros. That's a cool game. It has a boombox on the top.
Cool. Wait, on the Dungeons & Dragons?
Yeah. It's just got like a heavy metal boombox on the top of it for no reason.
Cool.
Like a speaker cabinet, so it looks like a boombox.
He has the 2004 Lord of the Rings, 2016 Hobbit Best from Jersey ever. Jack. And he says his rarest is the 2019 Heavy Metal by Stern.
Cool game. Yeah, that came and went really fast. Heavy Metal got Stern to make a short limited run of Heavy Metal games, and they kind of do boutique one-offs based on two different designs. One is based on a kind of slow game, and then one is based on a home game for Spider-Man. So they're kind of interesting. You can basically, if you have lots of money, you can get like 1,000 or 500 machines, whatever, made by Stern. Via this program they have, and Heavy Metal do that.
Cool. All right, that brings us to video game 20 questions. Our suggestion this week comes from Marcus in an undisclosed location. Let the questioning begin.
Hi, did you win last week, Justin?
I don't know. Did we? Damon, did we win? I black out when we record this show, and I don't remember anything about it.
Yes, you did. I just need to remind myself what the game was. You won with Fallout New Vegas. That's right.
That would be tough, I think.
Yeah, we got
multi-platform and a weird in the middle of the generations.
Yeah, it worked out. Okay, did this game come out in the 70s, 80s, or 90s?
No.
Have we just run out of those games now? We're never getting them anymore?
Okay. I mean, our usual follow-up question then is, can you play this game on the Nintendo Switch?
No.
Oh, man.
Is it a Sony or Microsoft exclusive?
Yes.
Ooh, is it exclusive to a PlayStation platform?
Yes.
Okay. Is it exclusive to the PS? Well, I don't know. Just Sam, which one should we do?
Is it exclusive to an odd-numbered PlayStation system?
Yes, that's 5.
Okay, sounds PS3 or 5 then, right?
Yeah, okay. Is this a PS3 exclusive?
Yes.
I don't know if that was the most efficient. Whatever, we did fine. I'll take it.
Yeah, it's just a matter of like getting the other one wrong or not.
Okay. PS3 exclusive. Was this game made in Japan?
Yes.
Was it? Wait, we don't know if it's developed by Sony, right?
No.
Just that exclusive. Was this developed by Sony?
No.
PS3. Yeah, I feel like there wasn't that many PS3 exclusives just because they got kind of waxed that gen by the Xbox. But I guess not in Japan, right?
Would you describe this game as having RPG elements?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, there's some PS3 RPGs, wasn't there? Let's just see if I can remember literally any of them.
Dragon's Dogma is one of them.
Yeah, that's actually a really good shout. Dragon's Dogma is one of them. That was PS3, right?
I think so, yeah.
It wasn't like early PS4, I don't think.
There was Dark Souls.
Yeah, no, well, there was Demon's Souls. Maybe there was Dark Souls and Demon's Souls.
Is that what it's called? Yeah, Demon's Souls. No, yeah, that's what I was trying to think of. What are those two companies? Is this a FromSoft or Capcom game?
No, that's 10.
Well, I mean, so there's Final... I can't remember what was a PS3 exclusive. Was Final Fantasy 13 exclusive?
Oh, yeah, that's a good... Yeah, there's probably multiple Square Enix games. There's probably even a Kingdom Hearts. I don't know.
Wasn't there also weird stuff about Mass Effect? Or like, wasn't the original Mass Effect an Xbox exclusive, and then the sequel came to both?
Yeah, but the dev in Japan, so we can skip those. Luckily,
oh, yeah, you're right.
Thankfully, is this a Square Enix joint?
No.
Oh boy, this sounds like a Damien game. What do we got on the lower tiers, like Atelier stuff? And
yeah, I was just thinking about that. I think we had it on the show a long time ago, but there was like Eternal Sonata.
Yeah,
and a bunch of those weird games.
Yeah,
there's a bunch of Disgaeas.
Disgaeas, yeah. Etrians, Personas.
It could be. Which was the PS3 era Persona? Persona 4?
Because 3 was on PS2.
Yeah. I can't get this any of this stuff.
So what companies are those? We got Atlas and
PS3 is Ni No Kuni.
Ni No Kuni, that's a good one. What was that developed by Sony? No, it wasn't, right?
No, that was Level 5, right?
Level 5. So is this a Level 5 at Atlas game? Or Atlas game?
Yeah.
Is this a Level 5 or Atlas game?
Yes.
Okay.
Who published all the Disgaeas? I like
Ni No Kuni. That's really good. Yeah. Does this game have flat animated graphics? Cell shaded graphics, is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Well, okay, if that's your question, are you asking if it has cell shaded graphics?
Yeah.
No.
How many questions do we have left, Damon?
6 questions, I guess.
why is it taking you so okay. I mean, so I want to burn a question on this. Is this a strategy RPG?
No.
Okay, is it a Persona series game?
No, and that's 15. And I just also want to remind everyone, the question was, does this game have RPG elements?
Yeah, yeah.
I know, yeah.
But we got it down to Atlas, and I mean, does Level 5 have other action-y games?
Oh, wait, the answer was yes to the Atlas thing, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I get mixed up on like
maybe it's Catherine.
Yeah, I get mixed up on Atlas's relationship with Sega. Like, I can't remember. Like, what was Valkyria Chronicles? But that's a strategy RPG, I guess.
Or Megaten, right? There's the Shin Megami stuff.
What about because then Alpha Protocol was like a Sega game.
Oh, really? Too. Do we just need to narrow down to Atlas, or do we know Level 5 is Ni No Kuni?
Level 5 is Ni No Kuni.
Okay, and they wouldn't have had a bunch of other games?
Well, I mean, I don't know. They made a bunch of stuff. They made, but like, I can't think of anything else on PS3 specifically. They did Layton.
Yeah, great game. All right, well, it sounds like it's an Atlas RPG, or Atlas game with RPG. What other stuff does Atlas make? They make Catherine, they make...
I don't know, like I said, Atlas is a little bit, like, because they publish stuff too, and so that's where it gets weird. Like, what about Odin Sphere?
Oh, yeah, that's PS2. What did that company make for the PS3 era? Because we were just talking about that company.
What, Dragon's Crown, or was that PS4?
I've never heard of that game.
Yeah, that was the one, I think that was the one that came out a few years ago, the 2D. I mean, you know, it's the same thing. Mm. Oh, boy. The RPG elements thing, made in Japan, Atlas or Level 5.
I just might not know this game. That's the confusing thing about it. Sequels?
But you asked it. You said it wasn't a Persona game.
Yeah,
right?
It's not a Persona game, but it could be Megaten or it could be Catherine, right?
Did they do Catherine? I don't know. But that wasn't that a PS? Wasn't that like a?
I think that's set in the Persona universe, just not a Persona game. Is that right? Does this game have puzzle elements?
Mm, No.
No, it's not Catherine.
I never played Catherine.
Okay. Is this an Atlas game?
Yes. Two questions and a guess.
All right, we just got to get what Atlas game it is. This is not Persona. So I only know Omega 10. I don't know Atlas very well. Do they do Tales of Symphonia? Is that them?
No, that's Namco.
Okay. What?
Atlas didn't have anything to do with Demon's Souls, did they?
No, I think that's all from. I don't know.
So we eliminated all the Personas.
Do they do Etrian? See, I just don't associate that stuff with PS4.
No, it's PS3.
Oh, yeah. I mean, even PS3, I associate it for, you know, TS and stuff. And then what about the...
Is it helpful? I'd be helpful to know. Okay. Have we mentioned the name of this game?
Yes.
Okay. So it's not... I don't think it's Etrian Odyssey. I think they were all on like D. I don't think there's any console ones in that.
So
era.
You think it's the Dragon one, the Odin Sphere one?
Yeah. So it could be Dragon's Crown. Yeah. I. So we know it's not Catherine, and we know it's not a Persona.
Yeah.
And Damon gave us a clue by sharing that it wasn't.
And he would have said, because I've only mentioned series names, not the actual names of the game.
Is this game sort of a 2D fighting brawling type of game, Damon?
Yes.
Is it Dragon's Crown?
Yes.
Nailed it. That's a tough one. I don't know that game.
It's VanillaWare.
I didn't remember that sure game as being game. A PS3 game at all.
Mm. This was a PS3.
No, I don't. I legit don't. Even seeing it, I've never seen this game.
This was a PS3 and Vita game in 2013. Cool. And then it was ported to PS4 in 2018.
Yeah, so the PS4, I don't associate it with PS3 at all. I only played the PS4 version.
And then
this game
Marcus suggested this because we've been talking about Unicorn Overlord so much.
Yeah. No, and I remembered we'd had this conversation. I was like, whoa, I didn't realize there was that many games from that company that Justin was mentioning like 3 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of funny.
Yeah. Unicorn Overlord, I've decided. So I don't play anything but Stardew Valley now, but I've decided that when I come out of this Stardew fugue state, that like Unicorn Overlord is going to be my rebound game.
Cool. It's so good. Yeah, I can't stop playing it, but
looking forward to it.
I only ever played Dragon's Crown at launch in 2013. So I think I'd like to revisit this at some point too. It's like a dungeon crawling. Cool. It's like kind of like the old Capcom brawlers in the arcade, Sam. It's kind of the game.
Yeah, so much style though. It's like unbelievable.
It's great.
Yeah,
and then
I had no memory of this game being on PS3. That's weird.
Some of the lines of questioning I was worried about for you guys is that Catherine wasn't a PlayStation exclusive. It came to 360 also.
I don't remember that. Was it Persona related? It is, right?
I don't know that. I haven't played it. But Ni No Kuni is playable on Switch.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Good point.
Dragon's Crown, thank you for the suggestion, Marcus. Viewers, listeners, if you have your own suggestions for video game 20 questions, email them to me at the email address gamescoop@ign.com. And that is all the scoops that we have for you this week. Thank you, Sam. Thank you, Justin. Thank you to Jobert working behind the scenes to make this episode possible. My name is Damon. This is IGN Game Scoop. I'm going to Mexico this weekend for a few days. So I'll see you guys
next
week. Yeah. And we're out.
Ooh.
We did it.
Thanks for accommodating the late record, Justin.
Oh, yeah, it's okay.
Oh, yeah, switching days and everything.
No problem at all.
It is the same fucking chocobos over and over again. Tell you that much.